Okay, so why don't we get started? Good afternoon. Thanks for coming. My name is Joshua Blank. I'm the faculty director of the Graduate Tax Program. And I want to thank all of you, our students, our panelists, faculty, I believe some members of the press who are here today to hear our discussion. The end of the semester is just about a week away or so, and we thought it would be nice to have one final get-together to talk about a timely tax topic. And the tax treatment of capital gains and income inequality have been in the news almost every day for weeks, but little attention has been paid to the broader implications of our realization rule, our capital gains preference. And so this session today will do just that, and it's entitled Innovation and Capital Gains Tax Policy. We're honored to have a distinguished panel with us today, Victor Fleischer, David Miller, and Bill Weigel. And I'll introduce each panelist before he makes his presentation. And then you can see we have a microphone up here. We'll have time at the end for questions from all of you. And I should note right at the beginning that this event is being recorded in high-definition video for the benefit of our executive LLM and our part-time students, so that even if they're not here on campus, they can participate in this. So why don't I get started by introducing our first speaker, Victor Fleischer. Victor is our lead speaker today, and we've been very lucky this semester to have Victor as a colleague. He's been a visiting professor here at NYU. He teaches full-time on the faculty at the University of Colorado Law School. In 2006, Victor wrote an article titled 2 in 20, Taxing Partnership Profits in Private Equity Funds. And he presented an early draft of the paper here at NYU in the Tax Policy Colloquium, and then he published the article in the NYU Law Review. It's not an exaggeration to say that Victor's paper ignited an explosion of interest in the tax treatment of carried interest. That's the fund manager's share of profits. Following Professor Fleischer's paper, practitioners, tax academics, even, I believe, all the presidential candidates discussed this issue in recent years. And today, he presents another early draft of an article at NYU titled Taxing Founder Stock, which we expect to be as provocative and perhaps as influential as his earlier work. So please join me in welcoming Professor Victor Fleischer.
Thanks for coming today. So this presentation is based on my working paper, Taxing Founder Stock, which I've just posted on SSRN. I hope to have updated versions up soon. So under current law, most of us, in exchange for our labor or human capital, we receive a salary and it's taxed at ordinary income rates, top rate currently 35%. But if you start a company and you pour your labor into that company and eventually you sell the stock of the company that you founded, when you sell that founder stock, it's taxed at long-term capital gains rates of 15%. And even better, if you hold on to that stock until you die and you bequeath it to your heirs get a step up in basis. So they pay no tax at all on the appreciation of that founder stock, which they now hold themselves. So they pay an effective tax of 0% on the gains from founder stock. So why would we have a policy like this? It's normally thought that the generous tax treatment of founder stock encourages entrepreneurship, that it encourages creativity, that it encourages the spirit of invention, that encourages modern-day Da Vincis to unleash their creative destruction on the world and create new things, create new companies like Google, Facebook, Apple, Foursquare, maybe even Groupon. I was kind of amazed to see a $6 billion valuation on Groupon. If there was a way that I could short that, I would. So that's why we have this generous tax treatment of founder stock. Professors Ron Gilson and David Schizer, 2003, in a Harvard Law Review article, talk about this tax treatment of founder stock, and they identify it as a effective tax subsidy, that we should think about the tax treatment of founder stock as a well-designed tax subsidy to encourage entrepreneurship. And what I want to do in this paper and in this presentation today is to challenge that view about the tax treatment of founder stock. So imagine instead of an income tax that we have a consumption tax. Right? And imagine for simplicity that it's imposed simply as a retail sales tax of 35%. Right? And we're going to fund all of the federal government's activities with this federal national sales tax. And it's going to be imposed at the point of purchase, assume away administrative costs. So you just go to Best Buy to buy a television set. Television set costs $1,000, and you pay $350 of tax. Instead of an income tax, all we have is the sales tax. And now imagine that there's another line for founders. And so when the founders go to Best Buy, they have a founder's preferred line that they go into, and they pay a tax of 15%, the founder's premier executive tax, which is taxed at a lower rate, and they only pay $150 of tax. And there's even a better line for heirs, right? A special Paris Hilton VIP line where she goes to the counter, she gets a TV set, and she pays no tax at all, right? And it sort of turns the payment of tax into the world sort of George Clooney and Up in the Air, where founders and their heirs have a very different experience with the tax system under this hypothetical regime. And I've yet to talk to anybody who advocates that kind of a system under a consumption tax. And yet, economically, it's identical to the system that we have now. Right? If you pay no income tax on the appreciation of that stock, you have more income available for consumption, and so you're effectively paying much less tax on the wealth that you consume. So in my mind, this raises important questions of distributive justice. There are two main points that I want to make today. The first is that the tax treatment of founder stock is a conspicuous loophole in the fabric of our progressive income tax. And it's hard to imagine a theory of distributive justice that would lead you to design a system like this, where the very wealthiest people in the country pay tax at the lowest rates. And if you take a look at the Forbes 400, the list of the wealthiest Americans, right? Most of the people on that list did not get rich from their salaries. They're not lawyers and doctors. They didn't even get rich from carried interest, which I've written about before, although some of those folks are pretty rich. But the richest people in the country got rich from founder stock, right? Either they or someone in their family started a company which has grown into a very large company and created a lot of wealth. The other point that I want to make, and I want to encourage entrepreneurship in the United States, but I don't think that tax is the optimal policy instrument to do so. In fact, I think tax is particularly bad as a policy instrument. It doesn't seem to be having an effect on entrepreneurship, and I'll talk a little bit about the empirical evidence on that point. And so if we want to think about encouraging entrepreneurship, we should not try to tax entrepreneurs at a low rate. We should try and tax everybody at the same rate and find other mechanisms like funding basic research that could build a infrastructure for entrepreneurship. So very briefly, I want to go through the mechanics of founder stock and how it works so that you can understand the nature of the tax subsidy. So this is a diagram of a typical venture capital fund structure. The venture capital fund raises money from institutional investors designated as LPs or limited partners here. And these are pension funds and endowments. And they put money into a fund that's organized as a partnership. And the VCs here are represented by the general partner of the fund. And the VCs then take the money that they've raised from institutional investors, and then they go out and identify portfolio companies to invest in. So they look for promising high-tech startups that they can fund. And the portfolio company, one of which here I'm calling NewCo, is thus going to have two main owners, the VCs and the founders themselves are going to own the equity of NewCo. And so let's take two hypothetical founders, Mark and Eduardo. Who here has seen The Social Network? Okay, because we're going to come back to that a little bit later. So we've got two founders, Mark and Eduardo, and they're going to start NewCo. And so Eduardo puts in $25,000 of cash. Mark contributes some intellectual property. And they both also contribute a promise to perform future services. And this transaction is a tax-free creation of NewCo. And so they're going to take common stock back in NewCo. And then at that time or shortly thereafter, the VCs enter the picture. And we'll assume that a VC fund puts in $10 million in exchange for preferred stock of NewCo. And to keep the math simple, we'll assume that it's they're getting one-third of the ownership of NewCo in exchange for the $10 million. So there's a $20 million pre-money and a $30 million post-money valuation on NewCo. Right? So $10 million for one-third of the company suggests that the entire company at that point in time is worth $30 million after the money goes in. So how do we think about the tax treatment of what happens to Mark and Eduardo in this situation? They've contributed something to the company. It's at least partly in exchange for services that they are performing. And they have common stock in the company. And typically, just to go back here, the common stock which they've received is going to be subject to a vesting schedule, which is contingent on their performance of future services. And so the tax code has two different ways that it could treat this transaction. And the default under Section 83A is to treat it as an open transaction. We're going to wait and see if that common stock actually vests. Right? So it's subject to restrictions. We don't know the value of the stock until later. And so under the default rule, Section 83A, we wait and see. And at that later period in time, when the stock is vested, we're going to take a look at what it's worth and treat the founders as receiving that amount as ordinary income. So if NewCo is worth $100 million at the time that the stock vests and they own one-third, each founder owns one-third of the company and it's completely vested, they pay a tax of $33 million on the receipt of that stock. The other way to go is the Section 83B election. So this allows founders to say, I want to treat the receipt of that stock as a closed transaction. So at the very inception of NewCo, they file an election, the 83B election, and they pay tax based on the current valuation of that stock at the time NewCo is created. And so the key here is at the time NewCo is created, that common stock may not be worth very much. The VCs have preferred stock, which means that they have a priority in liquidation. And so the founders report a low value on the common stock. And in fact, they typically report a nominal value. In this case, it would be easy for the founders to say, well, I contributed $25,000, or I contributed intellectual property, and so I've paid full value for that common stock. If NewCo were liquidated under these facts for less than $10 million, all the money would go back to the VCs, right? Which makes sense. It was their money. They put it in. So they get $10 million back first before the founders get anything. And the trick is that the option value of that common stock, right? Obviously, Mark and Eduardo's stock in NewCo is valuable. It's worth more than $25,000, but we don't know how much it's worth. Right, because it all depends on the performance of those future services and whether NewCo is successful or not. And under Section 83B, it's easy to ignore the option value of that common stock. So these are just the slides showing the equivalence of common stock in a typical NewCo. And the payout here looks, you get a zero payout until NewCo is worth more than $10 million, and then our founder gets increasing amounts as NewCo goes up in value. The payout's identical to an at-the-money call option on one-third of NewCo's assets. So we have economic equivalence here between common stock of a leveraged firm, here leveraged through the use of preferred stock, or an option. And yet, those two things are treated differently under the tax code. If you get founder stock and make an 83B election, you get capital gains on the appreciation of that stock. If you use a stock option, you're not allowed to make a Section 83B election. It's treated as an open transaction, and you pay ordinary income when you realize. And so this is an example of regulatory arbitrage where we have two economically identical transactions or economically similar transactions, which are treated very differently for tax purposes. So there's two aspects to the tax subsidy here, deferral and conversion. Founders both get to defer income, so as the stock appreciates, they don't have to pay tax until later when they sell the stock, and they get conversion. Right, so they're paying tax at capital gains rates rather than ordinary income rates. So how do we justify this under current law? I think the only possible justifications are based either on entrepreneurial entry, that we want to increase the number of entrepreneurs, or on the lock-in effect, that we may be concerned about the lock-in of people who are holding large amounts of unrealized gains, not wanting to sell the stock. That could create an economic inefficiency. And here the empirical research is not sufficient, I think, to make those arguments, to support those policy arguments. Entrepreneurial entry is obviously the one that is on Congress's mind when it thinks about these issues. It thinks, well, if we lower the tax rates, we will get more entrepreneurs. But if you talk to entrepreneurs, tax is usually pretty low on the number of things that they're thinking about. It very much has a second order effect. So what determines whether you leave your stable job at a large company and go start a new firm? Well, it's much more important to think about geographic factors. Where do you live? Is there a labor market where you can find engineers to help you build your company? Cultural factors, right? Some areas of the U.S. are very good at creating entrepreneurs, and others are not, because of the cultural environment. So tax doesn't seem to have much effect at the margins. Instead, it has an inframarginal effect of rewarding people who would have made the decision to become entrepreneurs anyway, right? So on the margins, tax does not seem to have much of an effect. And as far as does law matter to entrepreneurship, the answer is yes, but these other aspects of law are more important than tax law, right? Immigration policy, securities law, employment law, right? There are lots of ways that law can affect the rate of entrepreneurial entry, but tax is pretty low on that list. So I'm going to briefly talk about potential solutions and why this is such a difficult tax policy problem. So I talk in the paper about four different approaches that we could take to equalize the tax treatment of founder stock with other forms of labor. And my conclusion is that there's no good way to fix this if we have an income tax with a realization doctrine and a capital gains preference. So I'll just highlight one of the problems that comes up. And that's trying to distinguish between founders and investors. So if you assume that we have a capital gains preference where investors pay a low rate of tax on their investment gains, how do you distinguish between a founder and someone else who simply invests money in the company? And even if we do draw that distinction, it doesn't necessarily seem like the right result. Right? So going back to the social network, right? Mark is clearly a founder, right? He's clearly contributing his labor to create this great company. And I'm saying, let's tax him at 35%. But then what about Eduardo? How much labor did he really contribute? How much value did he create through his labor in Facebook, right? Do we treat him like an investor and let him pay tax at 15%? That seems somehow totally wrong, right? To think that Eduardo is going to pay tax at a lower rate than Mark. And so the solutions that are more attractive to me would have to be part of fundamental tax reform. We could repeal the capital gains preference. We could move to a dual income tax system, which I could talk about in Q&A if people are interested. And we could move to a consumption tax, right, where everybody pays the same rate on the wealth that they're consuming. That would be a partial solution. So this is part of a broader agenda that I've written about, where I've written a series of papers looking at the tax treatment of entrepreneurship and venture capital funds, private equity funds, and more broadly written about regulatory arbitrage. And so I think that the tax treatment of founder stock is something, as we think about a new tax policy, I think there's at least some chance we'll have important tax reform in the next few years. I think tax treatment of founder stock provides a new reason to think about a change to our capital gains policy. And I think we could change that capital gains policy without negatively affecting entrepreneurship. So I'm going to stop there and look forward to comments from David and Bill.
So thanks, Victor, for giving us so much to think about. And I know there are probably a lot of questions, but first we will hear some comments from our panel. And first we'll hear from David Miller. David is a partner at Cadwallader, Wickersham & Taft in New York. He received his LLM in tax from NYU in 1994. His practice focuses on transactional tax matters, and he's authored over a dozen articles on a variety of tax topics. He'll also be here in the spring, in the spring 2011 semester, to present a paper at the Tax Policy Colloquium here at NYU. He's the recipient of the Burton Award for Legal Achievement, which recognizes exceptional legal writing, and he was also the chair of the New York State Bar Association Tax Section in 2008. David Miller.
All right, I'm going to try to speak quickly. I have a lot to say about this paper. my first point is you really have a knack for identifying what I think are the really big issues in the tax system that dramatically affect distributional inequality. You did that with your carried interest paper. I think you've really done it again here. You write very clearly and logically. And for me, a practitioner, I found your paper really a pleasure to read. And I have no doubt that this will be just as explosive as the carried interest paper was. And I think in your slides and in your paper, you really accurately summarize the fundamental tax treatment of the founders of a startup. They contribute some relatively small amounts of cash, maybe some intellectual property, enter into employment contracts, take back common stock. Private equity investors invest cash for preferred convertible stock. If they're well advised, they'll go to a valuation firm, get a very low valuation on the common stock they took back, make an 83B election, pay a little bit of tax. They'll work hard, the company will go public, the value of their stock becomes worth billions of dollars, they never sell the stock, but they just borrow against it, they buy yachts, they run for office, they give it away, they die happy and rich, their heirs take over the stock with a stepped-up basis, and none of them pay a single penny of income tax. And as you mentioned, if they happen to sell their stock, they pay tax at most at a 15% capital gains rate. And I agree with you that this is a problem. This is one of the reasons there's income inequality in the United States, and I think you've accurately presented it. Now the first point you make is that this is the taxing the founders at this low rate is inadvertent. It's a loophole. But I don't really think that's the case. In fact, I think the evidence suggests exactly the opposite. So just this September, Congress passed something called the Small Business and Jobs Act, and in that act, Congress specifically provided that the first $10 million of gain on something called qualified small business stock that is purchased before the beginning of next year and held for 5 years is exempt from tax, entirely exempt from tax. So in your paper, you talk about Sergey and Larry rather than Mark and Eduardo. But if they formed the company or this company and they wait 5 years and sell their stock for cash, there's no tax on the first $10 million of gain. Now, that's specific. Congress just enacted it President Obama stood up and extolled that statue, said, look, this encourages entrepreneurship in the United States. So I don't really think this is, you know, some intentional loophole. In fact, I think there's a big segment of the population that thinks it's exactly the proper tax treatment. So I might acknowledge the subsidy. This is somewhat what intentional and maybe in contrast to the carried interest subsidy. But this was, after all, the Small Business Jobs Act. There's a limit to the amount of gain in exempts, and starting in 2011, 50% of the gain is subject to tax. So I really think this was intended to help the Joes, the plumbers, and not the Larrys and the Sergeys. But I do think that there's some intent to give this subsidy. In your slides, and even more so in the paper, you suggest that the 83B election, which permits the founders to pay tax currently at ordinary income rates on the fair market value of the stock they receive for services, is a loophole. I don't think it's a loophole at all. In fact, I think that's exactly the proper tax treatment. I think the problem with the picture that you draw is with that initial valuation, and not so much with the election, because all the election does is allow a taxpayer to treat a transaction in which he receives stock directly for services as if he was paid a salary, pay tax on that salary, and then took the after-tax cash and invested in the company. And I think that's proper. But if you are undervaluing the stock that they receive or the value of the services, then I agree with you that permits the taxpayer to permits them to avoid paying tax on the value of the services they provide. And this is a problem, I agree with you there. You sort of state that the IRS's failure to challenge this is some sort of subsidy that the IRS is providing. I don't think that's the case. I just think it's really, really hard to value this stock. And I think the same valuation problem arises when Sergey gives the stock away to his kids. And I think the same valuation problem arises when Google transfers intellectual property to their subsidiary. These are transfers between related party. There's no market for this stock. It's really hard to value. I think there are two other problems with the picture that you draw that you might emphasize a little or a lot more. The second problem is the failure of the tax system to tax a founder currently at ordinary income rates on the fair market value of the services they provide after the company is formed. And so let me just give you a little example. So take Larry Page. He got paid $1 in compensation in 2009, and presumably he paid his 35 cents of tax on that dollar. The value of his Google stock appreciated in 2009 by $8.7 billion. Now, some portion of that appreciation is probably due to the work that he put into Google in 2009. Maybe not all of it, but some of it. And the tax system will never tax him. Not only will it not tax him at ordinary income rates, but it'll never tax him. So that's the second problem. That is, even if the founders were correctly taxed on the initial contribution of their services to the company, they're working for the company from that point on, and somebody like Larry Page, who's only getting $1 compensation, his compensation is coming in the form of the appreciation of his stock. There's a third problem here, and I actually think this third problem is the biggest problem of all. And it's just simply the failure of the tax system to tax rich investors on the appreciation of their publicly traded stock. So let's just say that we were able to tax Larry on the fair market value of his services at inception, and Google paid him a fair market value salary during his term at Google, and he takes that, his after-tax cash, and he invests in Google stock at the same price as everybody else. His Google stock is still appreciating by billions of dollars a year. And again, the same problem that you identify for the founders, this applies to investors. That is, investors never have to pay tax on their appreciated stock. And if it's publicly traded stock, they could borrow against that stock, they could buy their yachts, they could run for office, they could give it away. When they die, their heirs get a step-up basis, or not this year, but next year, get a step-up basis, never pay any income tax on that, and forever and ever, whether they're entrepreneurs or founders or investors, they never pay tax. Now, Okay, so I think there are three separate distinct problems. You focus on the first, there are two others. So let's assume that there was the political will to correct one or more of these problems. How would we do it? Well, in your paper, maybe more than even in the presentation, you assume that the tax system must forever retain a preference for capital gains rates and must forever allow for the deferral of unrealized gains. And I think that these assumptions force you into second and third best solutions. And I don't think you should handcuff yourself. So just yesterday, the president's bipartisan deficit reduction panel issued its report. It hasn't been yet voted on, but it issued its report on changes to the U.S. tax system. One of the most prominent changes is to tax capital gains at the same rate as ordinary income. Okay, so don't give that up. Some people are taking that pretty seriously, and that would solve, at least part of your problem. I also don't think that you should concede unlimited deferral. So let me give you another solution here. This is my solution. I would give the entrepreneurs deferral until their company goes public. There's a few reasons I would do this. First, I think it's impossible to value a liquid stock. You could try, I think it's impossible. Second, as the Small Business Act indicates, the country really wants to encourage entrepreneurs, but within limits. So maybe, you form a private company, we're not going to go after you. I think the third problem, and this is a problem with an 83B election, if you were to value the services accurately, and again, there's this dispute what it is, you're taxing somebody where they don't have the cash to pay the tax. And for many people in the country would view that as cruel and unusual. Those are my reasons not to tax the entrepreneur for when they have the private company. But once that company goes public, and then let's say, and once the value of their stock is $5 million, then I'm fine taxing this person. And you know what I would do? I would tax them on a mark-to-market basis. That is, you look at the appreciation in their stock every year, impose a tax. I'm actually not so concerned whether you impose it at the ordinary income rates or the capital gain rates, but once you'll have the ability to tax them, whereas in the current system, they'll never pay any tax. At least, if you tax them on a mark-to-market basis, they pay tax. Their company's now liquid, they could sell the stock and pay the tax. It cures what is one of the greatest inequalities in our tax system, the fact that wage earners are currently taxed on 100% of their economic income, leaving aside what they can put in a 401k plan. But investors are not taxed on any of their economic income. And I think that's a real inequality, a fundamental problem with our realization tax system. And so if we can tax at least some segment of our population, and I'll limit it to your Forbes 400, maybe people worth $5 million or more, and I'll only do it on their public stock, because we don't know what the other stuff is really worth. And yeah, it doesn't solve all the problems, but it sure solves a lot of them, and it solves the problems you identify in the paper. So that's what I would do. We can discuss your other solutions, but I think you acknowledge there's some real practical problems in applying them.
Thank you. Well, thanks, David. Before we can ask our own questions, we want to hear from Bill, too. Bill Weigel is a partner in the tax department at Davis Polk in New York. He received his LLM in tax from NYU in 1979, and in his practice, Bill advises clients on a range of tax matters with an emphasis on private funds that invest in merchant banking, infrastructure, real estate, and venture capital transactions. In addition, Bill Weigel is a devoted member of our tax faculty. He's an adjunct tax professor here at the law school, and this spring he'll teach the taxation of private equity transactions. So I'll turn it over to Bill.
Okay, yeah, thank you, Josh, for that introduction, and thank you for putting on this panel and for inviting me. This paper raises some very interesting questions. I think, to me, the most interesting aspect of this paper is a kind of intellectual question of how does one distinguish between the rewards that someone receives for his or her own labor versus the rewards that someone receives from investment, given that we have a system that taxes those kinds of income somewhat differently. And so I think this, as I said, the paper raises some very interesting questions. And having said that, I'm grateful for having been invited to come. I also presume that I have been invited to provide some counterpoint to the viewpoints in the expressed in the paper. So I will do that, and I will do that because I do have some fundamental disagreements with the positions that are described in the paper, both on a theoretical level and on a practical level. And we've, I think David has maybe touched on some of them, as Victor in the paper, but I want to expand that a little bit. Let me start with the theoretical. I think if we think about the C corporation world generally, it is obviously, as we all learn in tax 101 or whatever the right course is, we learn that it's a two-layer tax system. We have a corporation that pays tax on its earnings, and we have individuals, investors, who pay tax on their income from the corporation. But that second layer, the investor tax, only applies to the shareholders qua shareholder. So as a result, when we have a situation where there's someone who is both a shareholder and an investor in a corporation, it can become pretty difficult to draw the lines between those two roles. I might put this another way by saying that in the corporate tax world, the distinction between services income and investment income is congruent with the distinction between two layers of tax and only one layer of tax. And the reason for that, of course, is that services income that is provided by an individual to generate wealth and profits for a corporation under a net income tax system gives rise to a deduction to that corporation. And so I would say that services income resides in the one layer of tax regime, and investment income resides in the two layer of tax regime. The paper takes the position that we should be trying, that policy should direct more of the income towards the services character, and that raises a fundamental question in my mind, just from a fiscal perspective, of why is it that shifting income from the service regime to the investment regime is a good idea. The paper acknowledges this concern, but dismisses it pretty quickly in my mind on the grounds that the corporation might not be able to use the corresponding tax deduction immediately, and that may be true in many startups, but I would submit that there are many, many cases where it is not true or may not be true. And for example, if we go back, Facebook is sort of the favorite poster child for this kind of a discussion. If we were to tax Mark Zuckerberg on, I don't know what the right number is, $10 billion worth of value that this guy who's younger than most of you has generated, I think what would follow from that would be a $10 billion deduction for the Facebook company, as well as a $10 billion tax basis in assets for Mr. Zuckerberg. And so given the practical difficulties of adopting a regime like this, which Victor also acknowledges in the paper, given that economic fact, I'm left scratching my head as to, well, gee, why would we really want to do that? Doesn't this possibly fall under the category of if it ain't broke, don't fix it? So I think that's the a kind of a basic, as I said, theoretical concern. The practical concerns with adopting kind of viewpoint expressed in the paper are mentioned there. I think they are somewhat downplayed versus what my view of what real life would be like. David has said a couple of times, and I fully agree, that valuation of illiquid assets is impossibly difficult. It's not only a tax law problem, but if I believe that if you go back and look at St. Thomas Aquinas and Aristotle and others, there are lengthy philosophical discussions of this very problem with no good answer to it. So I think that issue is there and is quite difficult in many of the circumstances that this change would purport to address. I'm being told that the time's running a bit short here, so I may try to go through this quickly.
You have 5 minutes.
Okay, thank you. The paper refers to the closed transaction approach as one approach for addressing this issue. And I would just point out that with the closed transaction approach, even if it did not have the practical difficulty of valuation associated with it, that it would, in many cases, and certainly in the very dramatic cases that are household names, would only capture a very small part of what you're looking at. And to illustrate, I mean, we could illustrate that easily if we went back, for example, and looked at the price of, or the value of Apple computer stock at the time when there was a first round of VC financing. And yes, it's true that Steve Jobs would have recognized a substantial amount of income had his stock been valued at that time, but I believe, and this is only a guess, but accepted as a hypothetical, that valuation might have been a few $100,000, it might have been $1 million, but nothing like the billions of dollars that stock is worth today. So the closed approach doesn't seem to me to get to the right result, or at least doesn't seem to get to the result that the paper is aiming towards. The open transaction approach, I think, suffers from another flaw in my judgment, which is that in an open transaction, what seems to be presumed is that all of the income that is eventually earned, that eventually arises from the stock, is attributable to labor and should be taxed as such. And just one example of why I believe that that's not really true is that I think most of us know the name Steve Jobs that's associated with Apple Computer. You may not all know the name Steve Wozniak. They were known as the two Steves who founded Apple Computer. The reason Steve Wozniak is not well known, even though he was a co-founder and I believe an equal owner of stock with Steve Jobs at the beginning, was that he's not as flamboyant a personality, and he kept a relatively mid-level engineering job with Apple for a period of time and quit working for Apple full-time in 1987. And so I would, presuming that he still owns his very valuable, again, probably multi-billion dollar Apple stock, which in 1987, when he quit working, I'm making up these numbers, let's say was worth $50 million, maybe $100 million, why is it appropriate to treat his multi-billions that he might get someday on an exit as income for services, wholly apart from the question of why does it make sense to give him basis and to give Apple Computer a multi-billion dollar tax deduction at that time. So I have that concern about the open transaction approach. And I think the what's called in the paper the qualified capital theory suffers from some similar practical problems. Let me close by positing a handful of hypotheticals that I think would be hard to address under the theories that are presented in the paper. And one that I would start with is suppose that you had a founder that did not ever raise any outside funding. And there are people who do this. There are There are some famous names, Paul Allen, Nathan Myhrvold, others who have made lots of money in an earlier startup venture and were now quite wealthy on their own, but who continue to start up ventures on their own and really don't have the need for venture capital financing from outside sources, can fund it all themselves. I'm not sure how these proposals would relate to those people. Similarly, someone who, and the paper acknowledges this, who founds and creates a company early on and doesn't raise any outside financing until a later date, leaves us with a situation where there is no obvious point at which there's a realization event to impose a tax, because of course we don't normally think of just issuing stock to another investor as being a taxable event for an original stockholder. And I also wonder about the example that David mentioned. What if a founder is paid in cash and turns around and uses that cash to buy the stock? Shouldn't that stock be treated under the investment rules thereafter? I would have thought so. And my last example, and this is to some extent a question for Victor, I would ask, the paper mentions a scientist who develops a brilliant idea and contributes the intellectual property in a 351 transaction to a new corporation, and thereafter just goes back to the lab and doesn't do any more work for the corporation. And I'm curious what Victor, what you would think as to what's the appropriate taxation of that person if we assume that the corporation becomes very valuable and she later sells her stock for $10 million. So what do we do with that person? So with that, I think my time is up. I could go on for a long time because this is a very interesting subject, but I'll stop there for now.
Well, thanks, Bill. We have now time allocated for Q&A. And I have a microphone. We also have a stand up here. And you can come up to use the stand to ask questions. If you're very shy, I guess I can go Oprah or Donahue style with the mic. But first, why don't we give Vic just a minute to respond, because he's now sat for the last 20 minutes to hear the comments from David.
He's been
David
taking
and Bill.
Notes.
Lots of notes.
The comments are very helpful. And the paper is still at a stage where I'm making substantive changes. So I really appreciate the time that you guys put into it. And I will take just 30 seconds to answer Bill's last question to me. So suppose you have a scientist who, instead of really founding and working for a company, just has a great idea. And she contributes that great idea to a startup and then completely disappears from the scene. And the company hires other people to implement and commercialize the idea. What's the correct tax treatment of the brilliant scientist? And I think in a system with a capital gains preference, we have to treat her as an investor. And I don't much like that result. But I think if we're constrained by an income tax system with a capital gains preference, I don't see an elegant solution to that problem.
I don't disagree with that. And I would observe, and I think David hinted at this as well, that to me the paper is really objecting to the capital gains preference more than to this particular aspect of how entrepreneurs are taxed.
Okay, great. So we have time for questions. I guess I just have one question. I'll use my moderator's privilege to ask a question that sort of amplifies something that Bill and David have mentioned, and maybe it would help us a little bit with that, with those questions. I mean, Vic, what's the distinction between this type of property, founder stock, and any other property that's subject to the realization rule and benefits from it? Warren Buffett talks about his 17% tax rate, and he owns his stock and his real estate. Is there something special about founder stock that makes it different from any other property which doesn't get taxed until there's a realization event?
Yeah, and I think it's the contribution of labor effort, the contribution of human capital, and the fact that if you get paid in the form of stock rather than cash, that there's a different tax treatment. It's not obviously as extreme in my mind as the carried interest situation, where to me that's a more obvious case that the private equity fund manager should be paying ordinary income rates. And this is somewhere in the middle. And in the carried interest debate, people kept saying to me, well, private equity fund managers, it's just like Bill Gates. If Bill Gates pays tax at 15%, then we should too. And I was always thinking to myself during that debate, well, I'm not so sure Bill Gates should be paying 15%. So let's think about that problem before I'm willing to concede the ground.
Great. So I saw some hands. Chris, I'll bring the microphone just so everybody can hear this on the video. If you could just pass this.
Hi, two quick questions for the practitioners. Assuming that this is a subsidy, whether intended or not by Congress, and presuming that you guys deal with entrepreneurs every day, whether they be your clients or your clients' clients, are they thinking about tax when they are deciding to become an entrepreneur or a lawyer, or is it sort of an unintended windfall that they get later on? And then my second question to Mr. Miller directly, your proposal was to tax on the IPO when the portfolio company goes public. How do you reconcile that with the trend in the VC industry where it's not to go public? And I guess Facebook is the preeminent example where they just remain private and find other ways of monetizing their stock.
Well,
I'll try to answer both your questions and then go to Bill. In my experience, sophisticated founders are very concerned about taxes, especially if this is their second venture. So I'm a little biased because the people who come to me and Bill, you know, already are sensitive to taxes, otherwise they wouldn't be calling either of us. But they're very sensitive to taxes. And I typically deal with very sophisticated people, so.
And before you get to the second question, I would agree with that. They are very sensitive. And another aspect of the paper that to me is not really complete is the statement that because we don't have clearly convincing empirical evidence to the contrary, that we should assume that the tax is not a substantial motivation. To me, the burden of proof ought to go the other way.
So that's my experience too. Okay, as to the trend, the opposite. Look, I think there are real advantages to having your company go public. There's liquidity that you really don't have if the company is not public. But you're right. That is, if what I am suggesting were enacted, it would create a bias for the private company. That is, yes, I've eliminated the subsidy for the public companies, I've created a bias for the private companies. And for those companies that are on the line as to whether to go public or not, yeah, if what I'm proposing is the law, on the margin, they're going to stay private.
I just had one quick thing to add on the sophisticated founders thinking about tax point. I think that's right. But I think that's an inframarginal effect rather than a marginal effect. So for the most part, those sophisticated founders who are going to sophisticated law firms, they're going to do the venture either way, and they're just thinking about how to minimize tax once they've made the decision to do the business. Whereas as a tax policy perspective, if we want to create entrepreneurial entry, we want to affect the founders on the margins who might not start a company at all, they might keep their middle management job. And so that's why the sophisticated founders example is something I remain skeptical on. But also a very good point about the burden of proof. It's given that we know so little from the empirics, right, maybe sort of the tie goes to the runner. And we should let the entrepreneurs.
I think you have another argument here, and the people in this room are evidence of it. So Bill and I, we're taxable at ordinary income rates on every penny we earn. We can never cash out. You know, we're in the most tax disadvantaged profession there is, other than your pure wage earner. And yet you're all in this room, you know, learning to be lawyers. So, you know, the subsidy's not working because you should all be, you know, getting your MBA or in your garage building PCs.
I'm pretty sure I'm never going to earn $10 billion, though.
Well, there's no lawyers on his 400.
So we have a question here in the back.
Hi, I'm Sean. I'm a 2L. let's say tax doesn't affect the entrepreneur whatsoever.
It does or does not?
Does not. Does not. That the entrepreneur is going to start the company regardless. What about tax effects on the investors, right? The investors are clearly going to be concerned about tax rates. Would they be less likely to invest money in entrepreneurs given increasing tax rates? What kind of effects does that have on the macro entrepreneurship environment?
You mean because the investors will worry that the working team members won't work as hard if they don't have that carrot in front of them?
No. Because the investors, if they're forced to pay not capital gains tax rates, if they're forced to pay income on their investments.
Well, I don't think Victor is. I'll let him answer, but I didn't take the paper to be suggesting that pure investors should be subject to anything other than the usual investor taxes. Although you do raise some questions about how much involvement a VC sponsor has and how active that is, and maybe that rises to the level of services income.
Yeah, it's clearly a concern for sort of complicated reasons. Portfolio investors don't end up being burdened as heavily by the income taxes as you might expect. The basic intuition here is they have losses as well as gains. So most institutional investors can offset the gains, the losses against the gains. There's obviously still some effect from an income tax, but it ends up being much less of a tax on risky activities like investing in venture capital than you might expect. But absolutely, it's something, if we were to repeal the capital gains preference, that's something we would have to think about, as you certainly do need capital to go into alternative asset sectors, including venture capital. My hunch from talking to people in the industry for a decade is that the most important input that we are lacking is the entrepreneurs, not the financial capital. That there, for the most part, is a lot of money sloshing around looking for deals. And in fact, that's inflating valuations of early stage companies. What we need is more entrepreneurs. And where I part ways from current policies, I think there are other things we should be doing, like funding basic research, changing immigration policy, that will bring more entrepreneurs to the sector. And that's the most important thing the federal government could be doing at this point in time.
So I think that, unfortunately, we're at the end of our hour. So let's thank our panel for such a great discussion. And just a couple of closing items. First, I wanted to thank Vic for writing such an excellent paper, and to David and Bill for such thoughtful comments. And we do have a parting gift, a token from the graduate tax program. And you won't need to worry about Section 83B elections, or hopefully never the disposition of this gift. Because valuation would be impossible, talking about valuation. But we want to award each of you an NYU tax hat, which we hope you will wear with pride. So thanks very much, and have a great winter break, everyone.